exercise, the parade route. They had all kinds of ceremonies planned. They just had to wait until these troops could be brought up. Finally, the captain of the Mary Powell, on his own, sailed down, picked them up, and brought them home without charging anybody anything, and brought them to the celebration. The same day, the Newport Daily Union had the headline, "This regiment of heroes, for such they have proved themselves to be, are expected home soon. They have made as noble a record as any rich regiment in the field. They have poured out their blood on dozens of historic fields and have a roll of heroic dead whose memory should be precious to Old Orange forever. Today we gather to honor Captain Isaac Nichol, Company G, 124th New York, one of those heroic dead who laid down his life to defend the Constitution, the document that makes America and Americans different, and to protect a sacred and perpetual union. He did so 159 years ago today, shot down leading his men in a desperate charge against overwhelming numbers on the second day at Gettysburg. Captain Nichol's regiment was created in the summer of 62 when President Lincoln called for 300,000 three-year volunteers. He quickly turned the job of raising these troops over to the governors. New York, all the states got a quota that they had to raise of soldiers. These are all volunteers. New York's quota was about 60,000 men. The governor of New York at that time, his name was Morgan. He divided the state into military districts. Each had a quota. The 9th Military District, which was Orange and Sullivan, had a quota of Orange had 1,200, Sullivan 600. Each town had a quota. Newburgh was to raise 285 men. Now, they'd already given large amounts of volunteers to the 56th New York team. They might have some difficulties there. The small rural town of Blooming Grove was required to enroll 43 men. The governor also appointed a military committee. Now, it was a military committee, but they were all civilians. And he wanted loyal and influential citizens to superintend the work of the enlistment. This was going to be a lot of work to get all these guys together. I just looked through the list of the first six or seven of them this morning. Their names, preface or at the end, honorable, which means they are congressmen or serve in state. Esquire, that they're attorneys or have something to do with the law. The committee was given quite a bit of latitude and power. And the first thing they had to do, they were required to do, was to name a colonel. They did not hesitate to offer the job to Augustus Van Horn Ellis, a captain in the 71st Militia, and he just happened to be home on duty, or from duty, to be available for this, and he accepted the job right away. So he went from captain to colonel at the signing of a paper, got on the train, went to Albany, got all the paperwork he needed from the governor, was back in Newburgh by supper time when he bumped into Charles Wygant, who was a livery stable owner, and said, "Why don't you raise a company?" And this is how it was done. The other officers of the regiment, now Colonel Ellis was a veteran of the Battle of Bull Run, so he'd been in combat. You know, he had seen it. The second in command was Colonel Francis Marco Cummins. Hello to all you folks. I'm just noticing you now. He was a native of Goshen, but he was in Muscatine, Iowa. He joined the 1st Iowa Regiment and fought with them at Dug Springs and Wilson Creek. That was a short-term regiment. Then he was the lieutenant colonel of the 6th Iowa and fought at the Battle of Shiloh, which certainly gave him some experience because it was a bloodbath, and also he got court-martialed for his behavior on the battlefield. But he had the military requisite, and he was named lieutenant colonel. The third job was still up in the air because they weren't quite sure who was going to be the major, and I think there was a lot of horse trading going on in these jobs. So how you got a rank was you brought men to these rallies. They had all kinds of rallies, and the soldier that we honor today, Isaac Nichol, when putting together the company for Blooming Grove, he brought 45 recruits Aniston brought 19 men. Another man from Newburgh brought about 15 men. The guy with the 19 men became the first lieutenant. The guy with the 15 men became the second lieutenant. To my knowledge, none of these guys had any military experience whatsoever. So it would be Colonel Ellis's job to train these, and of course they got plenty of on-the-job training. It's a typical Civil War regiment. 10 companies, each has a captain, first lieutenant, second lieutenant, 5 sergeants, 8 corporals, 80 to 90 privates. When you get the requisite number, you get your guys together and get them to Goshen. They signed the muster report. The first group that did that was from Newburgh. Charles Wygant, the man that Ellis bumped into, brought his men there. They signed up. They were named Company A. They would be the senior company. On their position in line is on the right, a post of honor. If somebody above him gets knocked off or is sick, he's going to be the, that's why it's important to these guys who are senior. The captain will become the major, and so forth. That's the way it worked. The second group to get to Goshen was the Goshen Company. They lived there. I don't know what took them so long, but they signed up. They're Company B on the left flank. Another post of honor. The third was Silliman from Cornwall, and he's in the center, Company C, with the colors. And it's a company, but also a color. All these signing in and so forth took place in late August, and by the 28th, all the companies were ready. On the 26th, there was a flag presentation at Goshen. Goshen was a small farming community, a crossroads county seat, but the population soared to about 20,000 on the day that the flag, this is what exactly what it looked like, was presented by the Daughters of Orange, a patriotic ladies group that raised $130 to buy the flag, the eagle on the top, raised $130 to do it and presented it to them. Soon after that, they received word that a federal officer would be there to sign, to give them the oath of allegiance to the United States. And on September 6th, they boarded the train, and off they went to what they like to call the seat of war. Now, I can't tell you too much about the intervening time, so we'll just jump right ahead to the Gettysburg campaign, because of course that's where Captain Nichol was killed. In that 10-month period from September to July, the 124th New York established themselves as a steadfast unit under fire. They did it at Fredericksburg, at Chancellorsville, and at Brandy Station. The three battles that preceded Gettysburg that they were in. Brandy Station was the largest cavalry battle of the Civil War, and they were infantry support for the cavalry. Cavalry battle is a fluid thing. You know, they charge each other, they fall back, and General Hooker, who commanded the army, said, we need infantrymen to be behind the lines to steady the cavalry. They'll come around, reform, and off they go. They performed very well. They're very proud of themselves, the same as they did at Chancellorsville. Right after the Battle of Brandy Station, word came that Lee's army had concentrated at Culpeper, Virginia, and was now in the Shenandoah Valley, heading north to who knows where. And so, 124th headed in the same direction. They were part of the 3rd Army Corps. They were in the 1st Division. They had been in the 3rd Division at Chancellorsville. So many casualties that 3rd Division was disbanded. They're now all in the, most of them are in the 1st Division. So they're heading to Gettysburg. They arrived south of Gettysburg on the 1st of July. That was the first day's battle. They were at Emmitsburg. They could hear the cannons. They were stalled there for a while, and then in the afternoon, off they went. They arrived at the battlefield after dark. No daylight savings time in those days. I looked it up. Sundown was 7:44, so they arrived after that, filed off the road where a peach orchard was, down the road a little bit, and past the cornfield, and into the farmer's field, and they spent the night there. They were ordered to sleep on their arms. Your rifle's right next to you, you don't unbuckle, you don't take anything off. We think there's enemy troops across the Emmitsburg Turnpike, the road they came up on. We have to be ready for them. Early in the morning of the 2nd, now, what is it now? Is it 10 o'clock yet? Is it? At 10 o'clock that morning, they're in the farmer's field,
cooking
breakfast, they're, you know, checking their ammunition boxes. They had, they usually carry 40 rounds. They had well over 100 rounds of ammunition in their pockets, in their haversacks, and so forth. They moved back. Their position was right in front of a place called Cemetery Ridge. They were at the south end of it, where the ridge tapers off, and then there's little Round Top over here. That ridge goes back up towards Gettysburg, and the place that's very, very important is Cemetery Hill. Now, that Cemetery Hill is the key feature to this battlefield. General Lee recognized it immediately as he came on the battlefield. We have to have control of that hill so we can cut off communication. If we push the Union soldiers back, we'll have their line of retreat under our cannons and so forth. When Meade showed up, the Union commander, he recognized the same thing. And so both of them are looking at this hill that's up towards the town, right? So in comes the 124th, Sickles, Old Corps, there's about 11,000 soldiers. General Sickles, who was not a West Point graduate, he was an attorney and a politician. But you know, sometimes attorneys and they don't call a political thing a campaign for nothing. You know, they have to have some of the same qualities that military officers have. And he's in a low trough, and he looks back to that peach orchard and figures, that's 40 feet higher than we are. There's a ridge line over here that's higher than we are. And if the Confederates get on artillery on those positions, they can shell us, you know, so we will have to retreat. General Meade said, no, don't worry, it's coming at the other side. And so General Sickles decided about this time to send U.S. sharpshooters and some regular troops as skirmishers. They go out and they bump into Confederate infantry going from columns into lines of battle. That news gets back to General Sickles and he says, aha, I knew this was going to happen. And so he moved his whole corps forward into the peach orchard, down the road into the peach orchard. Came back a little bit and then took a position on Houck's Ridge, the ridge he'd seen that earlier in the day. So the 124th was on that ridge. They're in Ward's brigade. General Ward had his 6 or 7 regiments lined up. At the end of the line is Devil's Den, big bunch of rocks. A battery comes up, an artillery battery. It places itself next to the 124th New York. It's Smith's battery. They're firing Parrott rifles, which are extremely powerful and accurate, and they can see the Emmitsburg Pike right about maybe 3/4 of a mile away from them. But those cannons can easily reach that. So they're sitting there, but nothing's happening. And the soldiers began to tell themselves, you know, nothing's going to happen here today, so we'll just take it easy. Now, I want you to understand that Company G and Isaac Nichol had a ringside seat in what's about to take place. The 124th line is in the woods over here. It comes up behind the first gun and maybe the second gun. So many different confusing witnesses, since it's kind of hard to figure out. So they're going to be behind an artillery battery. There's Company B is on the flank. He's the next company. So at about 3 o'clock in the afternoon, silence was broken by artillery fire. Confederates moved cannons out. Now, General Lee's plan for the day was to bring large amounts of troops through the woods, hide them in the woods, and at the signal, they would cross Emmitsburg Road. Now, he had sent scouts down there in the morning. There was nobody there. They came back and told him the Union Line runs along the Emmitsburg Road and stops in midair. There's no hill, there's no river, there's no nothing. If you can get around behind them, Lee figured, we will attack the flank just like we did at Chancellorsville and roll up the flank. And he would then be able to do what he wanted to do, and not just beat the Union Army, but to destroy it in Pennsylvania and win the war. Worked for him at Chancellorsville, and he was going to do it again. And as the artillery began to fire, they suddenly realized that they expected nobody to be in front of them. The way they would attack was the 1st Confederate Brigade would cross the road, wheel, and head towards the Peach Orchard. They'd occupy it, put in cannons, and they were going to go after Cemetery Hill. The next, all these brigades would go that way. They realized there was a bunch of Yankees in front of them. And if they do that, their flank will be exposed to cannon fire and artillery fire. On the spot, they decided to attack straight on to deal with the Union soldiers. So General Sickles, to his credit, although he never gets credit, ruined General Lee's plan. Now, so our soldiers sitting there, the artillery shells are coming in. Colonel Ellis has them lie down with their muskets next to them, right? He sees large amounts of Confederate soldiers coming. In his direction, although he didn't realize where they were, is the 3rd Arkansas, the 1st Texas, and then an entire Georgia brigade, 4 or 5 brigade regiments. And on the outside coming are Arkansas, or Alabama soldiers coming this way. So, his orders, Ellis's orders, General Sickles, wait till they get close, there's lots of them, you're going to fire a volley into them, fire another volley in advance. Okay, so the artillery shells are coming over, the Texans are coming, the Arkansas troops are coming, and they get themselves into a little creek they come down, and Smith's guns had done tremendous damage to them, because they were so powerful. These gunners are so accurate. And the 124th man that survived commented to that years for years how well this battery did. But eventually the battery runs out of ammunition. And when the Texans get down in the little draw there, the guns cannot be tipped forward to hit them. So now they're in kind of a predicament. The Texans were there, they got ready. Now they're looking up at the ridge. All they see is 4 cannons. They don't see anything else. They don't see the infantry because we're lying down. They start forward. Now there were over almost 500 men in the 1st Texas. There were 240 men at Gettysburg in the 124th New York. So they're already outnumbered 2-1. In the woods is the 3rd Arkansas with a big regiment. Here comes about 1,500 Georgia soldiers and about the same number of Alabama guys on the outside. Colonel Ellis looked at what was coming and said, "We're not falling back. What we must do is charge." Well, his major had the same idea and ran over to him early in this and said, "We must charge." And Colonel Ellis just pointed and told the guy to get back to his place. This is my decision, not the major. This was going on, that the major came again. But Colonel Ellis wanted them to be in place. The Texans came up probably the distance from the front of their line to this line right here. This is the distance. They're coming up. All of a sudden, Ellis gives the command, rise up, close ranks, come to the ready. Come to the ready, and they fired a volley right into the 1st Texas. And it stunned them. They stopped right in. Now, this was a terrific Southern regiment in many, many battles. But so they reloaded. Our guys reloaded very quickly. And in the process, Ellis had called for the horses to be brought up. He mounts, the major mounts, and the adjutant mounts. And somebody came up to the adjutant, whose name was Cromwell, from Cornwall, and said, a boyhood friend, and said, "You've got to get off your..." fellow said something else, not quite as eloquent, but it was the same thing. If this is it for me, dismounting is not going to solve it. The second volley, this is all done between the first and the second volley. The second volley hit the Texans, and one orange blossom broke. They ran like frightened sheep, back down to the bottom. Okay, well, they may have run like frightened sheep, but when they got to the bottom, they turned around, because now they're reinforced with Georgians. The colonel orders a charge, and over the rim here they go. Now, the charges were not, you know, running and screaming. It's a steady march. Just like the Texans came up with a steady march, the 124th went down with a steady march. And about halfway down, two-thirds of the way down, the major was shot from the source and killed on his instrument. And that's when the captain, I'm pretty sure, shot and fell, because his body, as it was described, he was at the farthest point of the advance. His body was wedged between rocks. Two or three of the men from the company tried to get him, to pull him out, hoping he was still alive. One of them was killed and the other two wounded. The major's body was rescued and taken back. He was already dead. The colonel's body was taken back and put on a rock, and the battle then progressed with a back and forth action. Now, the 124th had been promised reinforcements. They showed up a way too late. In the end, they had to retreat, but they did so only in the work. As they exited the battlefield, the general who was the General Ward stopped these two new regiments. They were first timers in the first, and said how proud he was, the 86th Ward and the 124th Ward, at how well they fought. And that was really important. The regiment went on to fight in all the big battles for the rest of the Civil War. When they left Goshen, they had 950 men. When they marched up into Washington's headquarters in 1865, of that 950 men, 130 were still in uniform. Give you a good idea of the attrition and the kinds of battles there. Now, one of the reasons why I agreed to come here today is because the Masons are to be congratulated for doing exactly what the veterans of the Civil War wanted to happen. They formed veterans groups for all kinds of reasons, talk to Congress about veterans benefits and so forth, for the widows and orphans and for the veterans themselves. But their main reason for existing was to make sure that the sacrifice of the soldiers like this one would never be forgotten. In 1868, the commanding general of the GAR, Grand Army of the Republic, the biggest veterans group in the country, had hundreds of posts all over the country, and the one here in Washington was named after Captain Nichol. He said, "We want to set aside May 30th every year as Decoration Day, flowers on the graves for the soldiers." And that's what they wanted. They also erected statues. They wrote memorials. They were in parades. They did all kinds of things right through the turn of the century to make people understand the sacrifice that the Civil War was. In that order, General Logan wrote, "Let no vandalism of avarice or neglect, no ravages of time, testify to the present or to coming generations that we have forgotten the cost of a free and undivided republic. If other eyes grow dull, and other hands slack,